Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. So we're here today to talk about the fanatical consumer and stoking brand loyalty. And we have some great speakers here today. I'm Barbara Thau. I'm the contributing retail writer for Forbes.com. And with me today is Ellen Latham. She's the co-creator and founder of Orange Theory. Welcome, Ellen. And we also have David O. He's chief product officer for, and I have to get this name right because it's a cool name that I say wrong, FabFitFun. Thank you.
Oh, it's both of you.
And we have a little video, so as showing is better than telling, to share your stories and to share your company stories. So Ellen, what did we see there? What did we see there? Is this?
Yeah, so Orange Theory. How many people know Orange Theory? Yay.
Oh my goodness.
Yay. Okay. Well, Orange Theory is a science-backed, technology-tracked workout. What I mean by that is I'm an exercise physiologist. I've been in the fitness industry for over 40 years, and I was very frustrated with a lot of workouts, and group training was something I specialized in. And so I decided, and this was going back about 11 years ago, to create a workout, a metabolic workout, 1 hour for all levels of people. We have a walker category, a jogger category, and a runner category on the treadmill, based on science. So I knew as a scientist that you have to get the heart rate, human heart is a muscle, over 84% for approximately 12 to 20 minutes in a workout to change the metabolism at the cellular level. So I knew that, but there wasn't a workout that did that, that measured it. So Orange Theory designs a workout in a lab in Florida. I have a full team with a clinical exercise physiologist, myself, and a medical advisory board of cardiologists. And we put together workouts that are very sound for all levels of people in a group setting so that everyone is successful. It doesn't matter if you're deconditioned, if you're a triathlete. I taught a class a couple days before I came to New York, and I had a woman who was 69 years old with she had a pacemaker a couple years ago on a treadmill next to a triathlete. And that could happen in the workout. Technology we have our own OTB, which is our heart rate monitoring system. So when you walk in, your heart rate, you wear one of the OTB monitors, flashes up on a screen, so you know that you're working out spot on. You're not overtraining and you're not undertraining. That's very hard to measure in workouts for varied levels of people. So basically why it's been so successful in such a short period of time, we're only 8 years old, our company, is because we've really made fitness simple. Really, really simple. You just have to show up. We took care of everything else.
Excellent. So when we think about, and so we just saw there, brand loyalty, can you tell us a little bit about that and your, the model and how it plays into that?
Yeah, absolutely. We're a lifestyle subscription box company 4 times a year, seasonal, and it's not monthly. We put a lot of effort into each and every box, completely personalized with our 160 question onboarding quiz and ongoing feedback that you give for each and every box. We're a continuity model, which means that our customers vote with their money each and every season, and that means that making them happy and our NPS score is high is our highest priority. I actually had asked our community to yesterday whether they could tell the people in this room why they're loyal and fanatical, and that's the rest of the video.
So I'm curious about, just in terms of when I think about brands that just naturally stoke loyalty and a fanaticism, brands that come to mind are retailers, Starbucks, there's Lululemon, there's Apple, and the connective tissue there seems to be, there's an emotional connection, there's interaction, there's community. And I know that your company, David, is the community and the content are one of the differentiating factors.
Yeah, definitely is. The subscription box service is about 4 years old, but we were a magazine, an online magazine, for considerably longer than that. We still have a million unique visitors a month just for the editorial side of things. And we still run it effectively. We run articles when we work with our box partner. Our community gets a post a minute. People are on there 24/7. I'm on there 24/7. I check it before I go to sleep. I check it before I wake up. I talk to my customers, private message them. They invited me to go to Vegas in October, which I'm planning to go to. They're a community. They're a real community. I treat them like real people. And our entire employee base is on that community. And they follow our Instagrams, and we follow their Instagrams, and we like each other's things, and they're people to us. And I think that's something that mass market companies don't typically provide customers, unless you're extremely, you're part of a VIP service. To us, everybody is VIP. Everyone is a person.
Exactly. And then in the community plays a big role in your fitness world.
Yeah, creating brand ambassadors was huge for the growth of our company, which in 8 short years, we have 850 studios open. We'll be nearing near 1,200 studios open and be in 16 countries by the end of next year. And that's in 8 short years. So it was very grassroots grown. No one knew what Orange Theory Fitness was. And to have to kind of explain a whole new fitness category, that's literally what we had to do. Quite challenging in any industry, nevertheless, the fitness industry. So creating each studio having that small footprint of relationship building that takes place was vital to us. Hiring the right individuals. Each studio only has about 17 employees working for it. A manager, a head coach, and other coaches and front desk. So the time we put into training and to cultivating really what we want those individuals to be doing on a daily basis with our members, the point of contact, the really caring about them, knowing much more beyond just throwing out a workout to them every day, was something we put a lot of time and energy into and really, I believe, has helped grow us immensely in such a short period of time.
And a lot of that is about personalization. How are you each personalizing? You know, what's keeping the secret sauce that's keeping that repeat, that sort of, that kind of fanatical engagement? What's the hook?
I'm gonna use a couple words that I think it's a little bit buzzy right now. Uh-huh. But we definitely use data science. We do clustering segmentation on all the different hundreds and thousands, almost a million customers that we have, and the ratings and feedback they want to provide us. They give their preferences even on things like fragrances, if they like woody versus floral, how many times they would like to work out, and the type of products they like. And the reason why that's important for us is we put a lot of effort into each and every box. We don't just hand out samples from a lot of, or overstock from different companies. We order into each and every box. And since we're ordering in such large quantities, we need to prepare 6 or 7 months in advance, which means our predictive abilities, our forecasting, our modeling, our updated testing for our decision trees and all that. Need to be updated and need to be right. And fortunately, our demand has been so high that we haven't had any inventory issues. We've never had to take a markdown on any inventory. And we've been in operation for 4 years, and we've been growing more than 3x every single year.
Wow. And the personalization question is interesting with your company because it's sort of, you were ahead of the curve with wellness and with tracking fitness. And how does that work with how you're
yeah, well, our you know, we really pride ourselves on being way ahead of the game with technology. We've created our own heartbeat, we call it OTB, heartbeat monitoring system, where we monitor your heart rate before you even get to your car. After you leave the workout, you will get a readout of exactly measuring what your response was in that workout. So today, I think, doesn't matter what you've got. You can't improve what you do not measure. And in fitness, that has been something that really hasn't been done well. So we're trying to be, and we believe we are the leaders in measuring heart rate in our workout, getting that information to our member, and we're going next level by the end of this year, where in each studio, you'll be able to go up to a tablet and you'll be able to enter information in regard to that workout and how your body performed in it, and you'll be able to compare yourself to another 40-year-old that is doing that exact same workout, because everyone does the same workout that's sent to each studio across the planet. So you'll be able to compare yourself to another 40-year-old in Hong Kong, because we have studios in Hong Kong. So how does your body in that workout relate to another 40-year-old, another 50-year-old, another 20-year-old? So this is information people want today. People want to measure. People want to know, where am I at? How do I get better? And whatever your product is, ours is fitness. The other things we create great brand loyalty is that we've got to be more than fitness. Today, you have to be more than your brand. You have to be more than what you're selling. If you're selling mascara, you have to be more than that mascara. You're selling it with a bunch of other great things in a box. So we have several events throughout the year. Those of you who rose your hand, you know about Hell Week. It's been the most amazing thing in the world. Hell Week is a week of different workouts. And if I tell you, people kill to go to Hell Week to get a Hell Week t-shirt from Orange Theory Fitness, it is the most bizarre thing you've ever seen in your life. And we have peak weeks, and we have dry tries, which is a dry triathlon, because we don't have swimming in our studios. So you have to go beyond your brand. We go beyond fitness.
Exactly. And the whole notion of meeting an unmet need. So how you've talked about that a little bit, and just the differentiation in the subscription box space, how you guys are different, and what that is. Content.
Right? It's nice having Christmas four times a year instead of one time a year. I think everyone wants a little bit of that, but honestly, the holiday seasons take up a lot of time. I'm sure all of you guys did the rounds getting gifts for everybody, and that took forever. The rest of the year, just for $50, you can reward yourself, gift yourself, something from yourself, and it'll be a surprise as well. So I think that's the need that's unmet. And it's not just something like razors. It's something truly surprising and in the category that you want. And for people that do not have too much time to go to the malls and look on Amazon and just browse for everything, I think FabFitFun is perfect for you.
And the international audience, you mentioned it. I'm curious what differences or similarities you found globally for each of your companies. Does anything stand out either way?
Yes, that is very interesting. You know, taking our product, and what I find internationally is that many countries outside of the U.S. do like business in a box. They like that. They want it already figured out. They don't want to have to figure out to metabolically charge the body, create a fitness program. They love Orange Theory, and they're banging down our door to come and put several of them internationally. So we're actually developing, over the next couple years, an entire department at our corporate office, international department, and we're building on that right now because of the numerous countries we're going into. And you're right, it is challenging because different countries, there's things that you have to alter a little.
Yeah.
In Kuwait, we have to cover the windows to do workouts in all female participants. There's different things that culturally we have to be educated on, which we are, doing. And but what I find universal is we all have the same bodies. Unless the human body is going to be developed differently, which I don't know that that's going to happen soon. We all have the same physiology, so how you train it is very similar, and that's what I studied, is how to train the human body for metabolic energy. And everyone's interested in that. So when we go to Japan and we're in Colombia and Mexico, that same excitement for great fitness is universal.
In terms of international, we're not truly international. We're North American-based. Mm-hmm. Our Canadian customers are a bit more accepting about shipping times. They do like our scarves and winter gear a lot more than maybe people from Los Angeles.
Right.
We do have a lot of requests from the UK, New Zealand, Australia for our box. But in terms of all the items in the box, we have to switch things around. Obviously, Australia has a different seasonal system than is normal. So we're making a lot of we're doing a lot of research, and we're considering how we're going to get the right experience in the right box. We're not just going to expand into these markets without knowing and planning exactly what we're going to do, and that's probably going to come in the next 2 or 3 years. It's not immediate for us. We want to capture domestic market here first.
What role does marketing play in each of your businesses? I know you talked about brand ambassadors.
Yeah, for, you know, our product, again, as I said, it's so hard to, because what is Orange Theory Fitness? It's really getting the knowledge of what this unique workout is. We've really created a new fitness category. So what I mean by that is when spinning was created, that was a new fitness category that Johnny G, who created spinning, put on the put out, you know, as far as within fitness. So that is a tough thing to try to get out there and just put an ad and for people to fully understand. So as I said, what really grew us is the grassroots of getting people to come in and try a class. That is the biggest challenge, because it is unbelievable the closing rate, in the sense of when you come in and you try your first class and you're really successful. And that's a big thing in fitness. Why people work out, let's face it, is for results. You want to see results. You want to have more energy. You want to look and feel better. That's why you work out. Okay, working out, massage is much more enjoyable than working out a lot of times. So why you work out is for the results. So we try to make it very simple, that it's a very simple, simple formula. You come in, and we're not only going to take care of the physiological aspect of the workout, but the psychological and the behavioral. I really studied that end of it. Being that I've been in fitness for over 40 years, I was very frustrated with people leaving a workout, a gym, whatever it be, and them not feeling successful or feeling it's not really a fit. No, I don't think it's for me. No, all workouts is for everyone. Everybody needs to physically move. If you're gonna age well, if you're gonna have energy, if you're gonna fight chronic disease. And that isn't something I made up. That is documented of how our human body is going to age. But then figuring out what the best exercise program for you are is what's challenging. So really wanting the psychological and the behavioral aspect that you know you're going to leave feeling successful, that's really how we marketed ourselves, is really by word of mouth. And then getting out there and just really encouraging people, just come in, try one class. We guarantee all levels, because you can do the walker category. Everyone can walk. You can walk. Come and try that first class, and you'll be surprised that finally you found your mode of fitness.
Yeah, and it's the word of mouth. It's the grassroots, and it's sort of in keeping with what how today the consumer is the brand and is really the best brand advocate. Is that something that you're...
I totally agree. I think if you have bad word of mouth, then you shouldn't. You're not going to survive as a business. Saying that, we're truly a world-class omni-channel marketing organization. Our influencer marketing team is the envy of most companies out there. We have Facebook working in terms of DR and PPC. We have Snapchat working at high volumes, and Pinterest. We're a partner with Pinterest. In terms of marketing online, we're absolutely great at that. But we also have real-life experiential events.
There you go.
You know, we had a housewarming party when we moved into our new office, and we had the Beverly Hills Housewives show up from the reality TV show. That's one of the benefits of being in LA, access to a lot of interesting people and talent. And we bring that all together. We are there for brands and our customers from your social media feed, from your Facebook, from your Snap, from your Instagram, all the way into your living room, where you can tell us about it on your phone. So marketing, we're prevalent, we're universal. I don't really want to use the word omni-channel anymore, but mm-hmm. we're pervasive. We're everywhere.
How much interaction are you having at some of the, talking about the some examples of brand loyalty where somebody tattooed your yes. logo. Can you tell us about
We that? Have had quite a few. Our logo is a splat, and a splat is a fat cell exploding, and that's what it would look like if you looked in the microscope at a fat cell exploding.
Oh my God.
So we call it a splat. And then your goal is to get 12 to 20 splat points in your workout, which means your heart rate was over 84% for 12 to 20 minutes, which we know physiologically will stimulate the body for afterburn. 24 to 36 hours after your workout, you're burning 20% more calories. This is all science. So I've had people send me photos of their tattooed logo on their body. I don't have one yet, but I really appreciate them.
That's right, I bet you do. There might not be tattoos involved, but there's a lot of interaction in your community, and it's because it's a lifestyle brand, it's not...
Yeah, I mean, I'm talking to them right now. They're still actually posting. My phone's buzzing. Good luck on the presentation.
Oh.
Yeah. Please send the clip.
Emotional connections.
Yeah. I think of them as people, and I don't think of them as touch points. I think of them as people, and I think that's the most important thing there.
We're gonna take some questions. So if you want to start lining up, I have just a couple of other quick. Questions for these guys. Thank you. So I'm curious about how you're measuring success, and you know, the return on investment, however you want to define that for each company, because it is a business, right?
Yeah.
So
In terms of return on investment, we run it like any other business. We've taken very, very little funding, and most of it because it was inbound requests from investors. We're well north of $100 million in revenue and profitable. With more cash than we started the year with. So in general, I think that's success. But the real success factor, I think, is our continued loyalty shown by our oldest cohorts of subscribers. We still have many, over 25% of customers and subscribers from 4 years ago. And that's getting better and better every single season. Some of them come back. In fact, that retention curve actually goes up a little bit recently and continuously. So I think that's success. We don't know what our ultimate LTV or CLV is going to be. We have to arbitrarily cut it off when we talk to people about it. So I think that's success.
Helen?
Yeah, so we're a franchise. And so our model is we have franchisees that we're partners with, of course. We have area developers. That has been huge in developing our franchise concept, where an individual owns an area, and then they build that area by opening up studios themselves, as well as getting other individuals to open up studios in that particular area. And that has really grown, just at such a high level. We have a pre-sale program before we open our doors. So 6 weeks before any studio opens, we have what's called pre-sale. First 4 years of Orange Theory, pre-sales, if we got 200 members who joined at pre-sale, we were overly excited. We thought that was amazing. Now we have the 500 club, we call it, because so many of our franchisees have 500 people. A studio has not opened. These individuals are pre-signing up, and all they see is a sign in the window and a bunch of construction going on behind the window. And we have so many new franchises hitting the 500 club that we're now going to advance it to the 700 club because that's what's going on with our brand. Studios, once they opened up, we thought 400 to 500 members at a studio, this is a 3,000 square foot footprint, an Orange Theory studio, was a fabulous membership. That studio did well with that. Now, most of our studios are 700 to 1,000 members in a 3,000 square foot footprint studio. So we measure it by that. We have 500 to 600,000 members right now on the planet. The goal is by 2020, 2 million people are doing the Orange Theory fitness workout.
And with tattoos also. So what's exciting and new for each of you guys this year with the brand? David?
We have an online streaming TV service. It's on Apple devices, Roku, Amazon, Fire. And we have fitness videos on there currently, but we plan to expand out to many different categories.
The cooking,
DIY, how to style the things that you get in the box, like scarves and all that. We actually, our customers are clamoring to also be in the TV, so we're actually working out the legal details right now on how our customers would create content that we would showcase. Because it would seem unfair if we were to get perpetual licensing rights, you know? It doesn't seem fair for them. So we want to protect them, really.
That's great. Yeah.
We want to continue our augmented reality recognition app. It doesn't just show interesting things. It actually recognizes the items that they're pointing at that's in our box and lets them rate it on the spot. And the reason why we want to do that is we want to feed our data scientists more and more and faster information with contextual information on where they are and what they're doing. In order to facilitate faster feedback loops of what things to order and how to order them and all that.
So proximity marketing, so in other words, if they're in the, you'll know where they are and then what they need, you'll serve them.
I wouldn't say proximity marketing, maybe proximity serving.
Uh-huh.
Because we believe, we have a hunch, that perhaps you could send a scarf and it'd be useful here in New York right now. But maybe people in LA, where it's a little bit warmer, wouldn't like it as much because the ambient temperature is a certain way. Things like that. We believe that geographic factors will help us, that data, any data, will help us improve the products that we send and personalize the products we send to each and every customer that we have.
Excellent. And what's new for this year?
Yeah, so much. I spoke a little bit about the technology and what each studio will soon have by the end of the year as far as being able to measure how you are improving. But I think what I'm most excited about as an exercise physiologist is that the research we're going to do. We're going to take people who are predisposed to heart disease, to diabetes, and with the lab that we created in Florida, we're going to measure what's going on in these individuals from the inside out, have them do the workout 2 to 3 times a week, and then my goal is in a year or two, I'd love to present our findings at a medical convention to prove that our workout is improving you. And not just say it in an ad and not just be compared to every other fitness product out there, but really have the backing and the proof that physiologically we can give you more life in your day-to-day life today and extend your life at the end.
That's a good note. Thank you so much. So we'd love to take questions. If you have any questions, please.
Good morning. So my question is about Net Promoter Score. David, you mentioned having some pride in the results of your organization. Could you tell us a little bit about your program? And Ellen, I'd love to know if that's something that you also measure at Orange Theory.
Are you talking about the actual scores themselves? They do fluctuate depending on where they're in the customer life cycle. So if they're in their first season, that's different from if they're in their fourth season. But they're high. I don't know offhand the exact, when we break out the NPS numbers, we give them by the age of the customer. So they all aggregate into kind of a cumulative score, but it's good.
Is there anyone that you benchmark against?
We want to reach one day Apple status, but that's everyone, I think.
Sure.
But we're better than many other retailers out there.
Thank you.
Yeah, and we definitely measure Net Promoter Score, and we have reached Apple's Net Promoter Score. So we're very excited about that. Our franchisees are very excited about that. We are very aware at the franchise level of getting input from our members and following up immediately. That's what raises your score, that people, we're keeping our facilities spotless, that when someone has an issue, it's addressed immediately, that our equipment is always up, those types of things.
Terrific. Thank you very much.
Is that it? No questions? Thank you so much for coming. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all.